Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's discussion, where we're going to be talking about the ethics, the law, and the practicalities of the use of animals in scientific research.
Animal research is a controversial topic. Three Alzheimer's Society Research Network volunteers met with scientists and the lay member of an ethics panel. They discussed the topic over tea and explored each other's perspectives.
So coming back to animal welfare then, how can I, as a member of the public, be assured that you have the animal's welfare and the animal's interests embedded within your work?
I could say we have three research network volunteers here who get involved with monitoring research.
Okay.
And I have confidence when I'm invited into an animal lab to look and see the research activity actually going on.
Okay.
The care, the welfare of the animals themselves. When that access is given to us openly and honestly, I feel as a lay member of the public that the conditions are more than satisfactory.
Yeah, but we're in a privileged position in going into those labs.
Absolutely.
As members of the research network. How does Joe Public, who isn't a member of the research, how do we know, if we're not part of this, that we actually, how do we find out? How do we know what the law is? If I get a mail shot asking me to donate to research, how do I know that they're following all these rules?
The people who do the research and the Alzheimer's people, tell me about the sorts of animals you'd be using in this research then. I mean, what you're talking about Drosophila fruit flies, you've talked about mice. What other sorts of animals have...
I've heard somebody uses worms.
Right.
Yes. So
why do you use... I mean, what do worms have?
So one of the things that is used quite a lot in brain research, if you like, is the C. elegans nematode, which is the sort of worm. And the reason why I think it's so interesting from my point of view is that it is the first organism for which we fully mapped out the brain and all of the connections between it. And then the idea behind there is, so we know how the brain is wired up, we know what the individual cells do, and we can observe the behaviour of this worm. And then by understanding how you go from the microscopic level, the details of individual cells and the network, up to the functional behaviour, we hope to sort of translate that to looking at other species, so mammalian species, for example.
So you say you've done that in a worm?
So I haven't done that.
No, it has been done.
The biggest problem as far as practicalities are concerned is that development of dementia in humans actually begins to occur some 15, possibly even 20 years before the first symptoms of the onset of dementia begin to be seen. Now, of course, you can't do any research amongst any cohort of humans unless there is some sort of familial link with dementia, and certainly not those who are going to develop dementia as a result of environmental consequences. What research you can do is to produce the mice that you're going to research on and take blood samples before the signs of dementia appear in the mice themselves, so that you can identify perhaps unusual molecules within the blood, what are called blood biomarkers, before the onset of dementia, which in the case of mice will be of the order of a month or two, as opposed to the 10 to the 15 years in human beings, and that is a massive problem.
But I think there's also another component that needs to be added to the need of using animals. When you want to test a novel hypothesis, you need to have control over your experimental conditions. So you have to have control over all the possible variables that could influence your results, including the genetic background of the biological system you're working on. And the main feature of human volunteers, whether they're patients or they're healthy, is that they are incredibly diverse. And animals bred in captivity are usually genetically homogeneous. more homogeneous than a population of humans compared to a human population.
So you breed them specially for that?
Yes, there are different kind of breeding techniques, and you can go from inbred techniques.
Just to be clear, I think it's an important point to make that with people are used in experimental conditions, clinical phase 1, 2, or 3. Yeah. So a drug discovery typical group will start off in a petri dish, then it will go to animals, then it will go to humans. The first stage is usually on maybe 10 humans,
yeah.
And then the second stage is usually on 100, and then the third stage is usually in a much larger situation. So actually, humans are used in experimental conditions.
You're giving me lots of reasons why it's more efficient and perhaps cheaper, I don't know, to use animals in that preliminary stage. But I'm still coming back to the fact that you're not valuing animals and giving them equal rights in the same way. And that if you make that decision, I think that's your choice to make that decision. But you need to be aware that that's a decision you've made.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. So I'm hearing some quite strong arguments here for scientific reasons for using animals in research. But coming back to the ethics, is it ethical to ever use animals in research?
Can I say what I think?
Yes, please.
Whatever choice you make will have a moral, ethical fallout somehow, right? So I could say, let's not use animals at all because animals are not able to give their consent, so we should not be using them. That's fine. That will result, as a matter of fact, in freezing scientific development and progress. That's it. We need to live with that consequence, right? On the other hand, I can say, no, let's use the animals and let's keep promoting progressing science. And then I have to live with the moral consequences of sacrificing animals. Now, I don't think we really need to polarize ourselves into one choice or another. We could say, this is the moral fallout of using animals. We're using sentient creatures without their consent. So I think what we need to do is to trigger an historical path. Right? An historical path that uses animals today, but every effort is made to progressively reduce the use of animals until asymptotically at some point we will not use them anymore.
And I think that's really interesting because I was going to make a historical argument as well, because actually if we go back even only 50 years, we were experimenting on human beings.
Well, what gives me the greatest concern is conflating human rights with animal rights, with the suggestion that animals enjoy equal rights to human beings. What we have to come to terms with is the fact that human rights are bound up by law and encompasses the whole of the way in which we conduct ourselves. Human rights are very, very much tied up with the responsibilities that go with having those rights. By definition, therefore, animals are unable to have the same degree of protection, the same enjoyment of rights as humans do. The problem, as I see it, is that it's very easy to sit on the moral high ground and say that animals should have exactly the same treatment as human beings, when in fact that cannot possibly be the case. It's the responsibility of we, as human beings, if you like, the higher species, if that's how you want to define us, to take responsibility for the better welfare of animals, whichever way you look at it. Animals, whether it be for food, clothing, or research.
Now, there is an enormous amount of work being, as I understand it, being done to look at other ways of doing research. You will know about
that. So are you saying that actually it will come, then we don't need to use animals?
Well, it's a possibility. That's what I'd like to think, because things have changed, and I know there's that work being done on using other methods, you know, different methods better than I do. And I think everyone wants to do that. There is this sort of like moral imperative to move that, a progression. So I suppose being optimistic, I want to think that. I think there has been change.
So if we choose the animal path, then that's our ethical choice. But you could equally be a vegan, for instance, who don't want to use animals for food, research, or anything. And that's an equally valid choice. So as scientists, we're just saying we've chosen this course and we're holding our hands up and saying that's our ethical choice. And it's no greater than the ethical choice, which is the vegan choice.
Okay, and our responsibility then is to make sure that we do it in such a way that we treat the animals as well as possible, we use as few as possible, we harm them as little as we can.
And we seek alternatives where they are available.
And massively put research into
that. Coming back to what Carl just said about alternatives. So can you give us some examples of where there's an alternative approach?
So what I do is I develop, if you like, mathematical representations of living systems in most cases, brain cells, neurons. Mm. And the idea there is that in the computer environment, we can do so-called experiments quickly, cheaply, without the use of any more animals, to sort of explore different hypotheses and to identify mechanisms that could be involved in certain kinds of diseases. And the idea is then I take this back to, say, Francesco, and I say, I think this is going on. Francesco can then test it. But the idea is that we're maximizing the use of the available data, and we're trying to replace the animal research with a good computer simulation that can capture all of the dynamics that we see in the real system.
And I think we'll leave it there for that particular session. Thank you very much.